Good morning. Thank you for joining us on our live stream this morning, April 12th, 2020. We're going to start this morning with a continued discussion of our study on miracles in our class time, which will be about the first 30 minutes or so. And then at 10:30, Lord willing, we'll move into our session and period of worship with a Bible reading, some prayers, a message before the Lord's Supper, and then our Sunday sermon. Again, we're thankful for all those that have joined us via our Facebook stream, also those that are watching on YouTube, and those that are watching later. We're thankful for your presence and thankful for your support of the work that we're trying to accomplish here at the Burleson Church of Christ. Before we get started in our Bible study, let's pause for a moment and have a word of prayer, and then we'll get into our discussion. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this beautiful day you've given us. Father, we're thankful for the opportunity that we have and the privilege that we have on the first day of every week to worship Thee, the only living and true God. We pray that even though we cannot all be here at the same place at the same time, that we are still joined together in mind and in heart and in purpose. Father, we're thankful for the means of technology that bring us together in this way. We pray for our nation that this virus, this scourge might continue to subside and that we might resume some sense of normalcy in our lives. Father, we continue to pray especially for the folks in our local nursing home. We pray for the staff. We pray for the residents, all those that are directly affected by the virus, those that are working with them. We pray also for their families, for their comfort, for their ease of mind. And Father, we're thankful for the work that's done by the staff. We love them and appreciate them so much, and we ask your blessings on them and their families during these difficult days. While we're mindful of our folks that are sick, that are otherwise facing difficulties in life with their health and other things, those that have lost their employment, those that struggle financially in other ways, we pray that that things might again return to normal as soon as possible, that folks can get back to work and do the things that they need to do the things that they love to do. And we just ask your blessings on our nation and on our state and on our community as we think about these things from day to day. Father, we're always mindful of your love and your grace. We're thankful for these that have been extended to us in the giving of your Son and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We're thankful for his life. We're thankful for his death. We're thankful for his resurrection. We're thankful for the hope of his return. Father, we pray that wherein we have failed you in any way with regard to our words or deeds, that we'll repent and that we trust that you will forgive us when we repent and confess our sins. And Father, we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, last Lord's Day morning, we began a discussion of the subject of miracles, primarily because there seems to be a lot of confusion and just ignorance about the Bible matter, the Bible subject of miracles. And that was evident from a lot of comments that I've received over the last several days. And so we started this discussion last week, first of all, trying to clarify in some way what constitutes a miracle. And we began by noting that when words are used improperly, then confusion about those words arises. And then when there is confusion about the word, then there is error in thought concerning that word or that subject. And with that confusion, with that error, comes error in teaching, error in belief, and then ultimately error in life. And so we begin by looking at how the world uses the term miracle. For example, they talk about the miracle of birth. And of course, birth is not a miracle. It is a physical process. We can see it and we can explain it. We know how it happens. It doesn't require divine intervention. I was going back and listening to a podcast that I was a part of. And Russ, if you're watching this, I appreciate the opportunity to be on with you back in November to talk about miracles and cessationism. And I recall after listening to that podcast again, the accident that I had not witnessed but had read about when I was over in North Georgia, where a semi-truck had hit a parked state trooper's SUV. And the result of that crash was just horrific. And one would look at that SUV and say, there's no way anybody survived that. And yet the trooper walked away with only minor injuries. And people will say, well, that's a miracle. Well, no, it's not a miracle. And so the Bible, and we're going to study how the Bible uses that word and similar words today. But in just a brief definition, and I'm going to use again the Webster's Ninth Collegiate Dictionary definition of miracle, says, a miracle is an extraordinary event manifesting divine intervention in human affairs. In other words, there is the unmistakable work of God that is above and beyond all natural law and explanation. And so that's what a miracle is, and that's how the Bible uses the term miracle, but it's not how man uses the term miracle, and it's not how man applies the concept of the miraculous in common thinking today. And so first of all, we want to understand what is a miracle. And a miracle is, I think, best defined by Acts 4 and verse 16, wherein the unbelieving Jews said of the man and who had been healed in Acts 3 at the temple gate and had said of the apostles that a notable miracle has been performed through these men is manifest to everyone in Jerusalem. And we cannot deny it. And so we see three aspects that are required for a true miracle. One, it has to be notable. In other words, we know exactly what the result is. It's manifest. It's not done in a corner, not done somewhere in the deep recesses of the African jungle or somewhere where nobody really has access to see it. And then lastly, it's undeniable. In other words, whatever it is that has transpired is undeniably the work of God in a supernatural way. And so that's not what we're finding in the world today. It's not what we see in the world today. But yet we're finding the use of this term miracle has become so watered down and so nebulous that it really doesn't mean anything at all. So we want to restore in our minds and in our thinking what the Bible says about the term miracle. And so what I want to do, if you have your Bibles, and I hope that you do, open to the book of Acts chapter 2, and we're going to look at verse 22, and we're going to look at the testimony of Peter on the day of Pentecost. And we're going to look at another text as well that correlates or corresponds to this text. But we're using these two verses to find our words, to find our terminology. Then we're going to look at how the Bible uses those particular words in the biblical text. And so in Acts 2 and verse 22, Peter says, "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved by God among you by miracles, wonders, and signs." Those are going to be our three words right there. Miracles, wonders, and signs. Which God did, and here's going to be another key point later on, by him in your midst, as ye yourselves also know. And so Peter points to the miracles, the wonders, and the signs that were done by Jesus himself among them, and that these were, again, notable miracles, they were manifest miracles, they were known by those believers and otherwise, and says, "And as ye yourselves also know," and these were people who did not believe in Jesus, but Peter points them back to the miracles that Jesus had performed, said, you know he did these things. And so miracles, wonders, and signs. Now, with our corollary, our corroborating verse, Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 4. It says, God also, talking about, says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first was spoken of by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by those who heard him, God also bearing witness, both with signs and wonders and various miracles. There's our words again, signs, wonders, and miracles, and gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will. So there's going to be our three words, miracles, wonders, and signs. These are the three words found in Acts 2:22 with regard to the work of Christ. It's the words, same three words that are found in Hebrews 2, verses 3 and 4 in regard to the work of the apostles. And so we're going to look at each of these words and how the New Testament uses them so that we can come to a clear understanding of what the Bible is talking about when the Bible speaks of miracles, wonders, and signs. Now first, the word miracles here in Acts 2 and verse 22. And we're going to go in that order, miracles, wonders, and signs. The word miracles there comes from the word dunamis. The word dunamis. And this word appears, I think, about 119 times in our New Testament in some form. Now, this word dunamis is translated a number of different ways into the English language and in a variety of contexts means different things, both miraculous and non-miraculous. So first, let's note the non-miraculous use of this word. Now, again, in the context in which we have quoted this verse, Acts 2 and verse 22, there's no question that its intent was miraculous. But we want to be complete, we want to be thorough with our use of the word and how the Bible uses it. For example, in Matthew 25 and verse number 15, the Bible speaks in Jesus is giving us the parable of the talents. And in verse 15 of Matthew 25, it says that the master gave to each one according to his ability. The word ability there is the word dunamis. According to his power or his ability. And so that's obviously a non-miraculous use of the word. In 1 Corinthians 14, and in about, verse 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, right in through that section of text, in a discussion of speaking in tongues and other miraculous gifts, Paul rebukes the church at Corinth for their abuse of real spiritual gifts, and he talks about the flute, the harp, and the trumpet. And it says, if these things make an uncertain sound, who's going to know to prepare himself? Who's going to know where to go or what to do? And then he goes on to talk about that each individual language has meaning there in 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 11. And again, he's talking about these words have power, they have meaning. That's our word, again, dunamis. And then lastly, at least in my mind, the most well-known text wherein the word is not only utilized, but identified and isolated and pointed out, is Romans chapter 1 and verse 16. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is God's power to save all that believe, to the Jew first and also to the Gentile. And so the word power there in Romans, it is the gospel is God's power. It is God's dunamis to save all who believe. So that's also a non-miraculous use of the word. But now, very quickly, the miraculous use of the word. For example, it's defined or translated as miracles in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 10, and 1 Corinthians 12 and verses 28 and 29. It is translated in a miraculous sense as power in Acts 1 and verse 8. You shall receive power, Jesus promised his apostles there just before his ascension and about 10 days before the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. But that power of Romans 1:16 is non-miraculous, but the power that Jesus talked about in Acts 1:8 is miraculous. And then lastly, in Romans 15 and verse 19, it speaks about mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Holy Spirit. The word mighty there and the word power there come from the same word. And so mighty signs. And so this word is used and translated miracles, power, mighty, and these words all refer to the miraculous. Then secondly, our word, miracles, wonders, and signs. The word wonders is not nearly as common in the New Testament text. Only appearing 16 times in the New Testament. Comes from the Greek teras, T-E-R-A-S, if you were going to anglicize it or transliterate it. And Romans 15 and verse 19, mighty signs. Note what we said, dunamis teras, mighty signs, powerful signs. The word signs there is the word teras, and it is obviously in the miraculous sense. In Acts 2 and in verse number 43, it says, then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were performed or done through the apostles. There's the wonders, obviously a miraculous manifestation in that particular case. So there's our word wonders, miracles, wonders. Then lastly, a word that we've already mentioned several times in our discussion of miracles and wonders, the word signs. And that is from the word Simeon, and it appears 62 times in our New Testament. Now, this word also is used in a non-miraculous sense and a miraculous sense. In the non-miraculous sense, in Luke 2 and verse 12, as the angel appeared to the shepherds at night, it says they would receive, this shall be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. It says this shall be a sign to you. Not miraculous at all, because they're going to go to a place and there's going to be a baby in that place, and they're going to tell you how he's dressed and where he's going to be laying. And so the word sign, this shall be a sign to you. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and in verse 17, in the close of that little epistle, Paul said, the salutation I have written in my own hand, which is the token or sign in all my epistles. Token or sign. In other words, Paul didn't write the entirety of the epistle. He only wrote the introduction or the salutation of the epistle as a sign to those who were receiving it, knowing that they would recognize his handwriting. Thus, they would know that even though the entire epistle was not written in Paul's hand, the salutation would be written in Paul's hand as a sign that the rest of the epistle also came from Paul. And so there's the non-miraculous use of the word Simeon. But now, in the miraculous sense, in Matthew chapter 12 and verses 38 and 39, when the skeptical, unbelieving Jews came to Jesus and they said, Master, we would see a sign from you. Now, what were they asking for? They were asking for a miraculous deed, some type of miraculous deed to be done as evidence of Jesus being who he says or said that he was. And then the word is also, Simeon is also rendered miracles. And John was he used the word Simeon and was translated miracles in John 2 and verse 11 with the wedding feast at Cana. This is the first, literally, this is the first sign, but many translations say this is the first miracle. In John 2 and verse 23, John 4, 54, John 6 and 14, we find this word Simeon used, but it's translated, again, now I'm using the New King James, so you might be looking at maybe an ESV or some other translation. And so I'm simply going by how it's rendered in the New King James. So if you're reading along, you're taking these notes, the words, the English words are not the same. Well, I want you to understand perhaps why. But then in Luke 23 and verse 8, when Jesus stood before Herod, before his crucifixion, the Bible says that Herod hoped to see a sign, some renderings, a miracle to be performed by Jesus, which he did not accommodate that desire or that request. But again, the word is in all of these cases in John, this case in Luke 23 and verse 8 is in the realm of the miraculous. So miracles, wonders, and signs. And so now I want to move from there into a distinction between providence and miracles. Now I mentioned this last week, that miracles are the unmistakable, inarguable, undeniable manifestation of the work of God in a supernatural way. In other words, the laws of nature have been suspended, and God has worked in an obvious and undeniable way. Some people have confused praying and healing with the miraculous. I believe in the power of prayer, and I believe that God works in healing, but not in a miraculous way, because of what the Bible says about miracles, wonders, and signs. Now, the problem that most people have is they think that anytime somebody gets sick and you pray for them and they get better, that it's a miracle. Which just simply shows they don't understand how the Bible uses the word, and they want to use it the way that they've been taught or the way that they want to use it, but that's just not correct. And again, diminishes the meaning of the word, diminishes the meaning of the biblical text, and ultimately leads to error in thought, in teaching, and in practice. I believe in healing. When my mother was diagnosed with multiple myeloma, we began to pray for her. We've prayed for her as she receives her chemo. We've prayed for her as she's had surgeries in recent weeks. And we've prayed that all the things that are being done for her will have their desired and intended effect. And thus far, we have been blessed immeasurably by the results of the tests and the procedures that have been done. I believe that God had a hand in that. But it's not a miraculous hand, it is a providential hand. Because again, look at the terminology that we just studied and see if it fits the description of providential healing, and it does not. So, I am not a deist. I don't believe that God made the world and just wound it up and turned it loose, and that he has no interest or that he has no interaction in the affairs of men. I believe in the providence of God. God working through natural means and methods to accomplish his will. Non-miraculous. And I can point to many events in my life that I believe are providential. I cannot prove it. That's the thing about providence. A miracle doesn't have to be proven because it's obvious, it's manifest, it's undeniable. Providence can only be believed. It can neither be proven nor disproven. And so therein lies the difference. So I believe in the providence of God. I believe in healing. Now, herein lies one of the difficulties. Again, I mentioned about that some people believe that all healing is miraculous. Now, C.S. Lewis was a brilliant man and an incredible writer. But Lewis believed the error that all healing is miraculous. And yet, even in his own writings, in trying to defend the idea that all healing is miraculous, he actually makes the case for providence. In his book, Miracles, published in 1947 on pages 143 and 144, here's what C.S. Lewis says. He says, there is a sense in which no doctor ever heals, and the doctors themselves would be the first to admit this. The magic, again, he's using the term accommodatively. The magic is not in the medicine, but in the patient's body, in the recuperative or self-corrective energy of nature. Now see, he's made my argument. He says, it's the result of nature. But the miraculous is supernatural. It's beyond nature. It's against nature. It's producing something that nature itself cannot and will never, ever produce, such as a blind man receiving his sight because somebody spit in the mud and put mud on his eyes and told him to go wash. A man with a withered hand, immediately his hand is restored. The raising of the dead after 4 days. See, these are the things that the Bible says are miracles, and they go above, far above and beyond nature. But Lewis says what he's calling a miracle is actually the result of nature, again, which simply just shows he doesn't understand the nature of providence, or he's failing to make a proper distinction between providence and the miraculous. He says, we speak for convenience of the doctor or the dressing healing a cut. But in another sense, every cut heals itself. No cut can be healed in a corpse. That same mysterious force which we call gravitational when it steers the planets and biomechanical, when it heals the body, is the efficient cause of all recoveries. And that energy proceeds from God in the first instance. All who are cured by Him. Not merely in the sense that His providence provides them with the medical assistance and the wholesome environments, but also in the sense that their very tissues are repaired by the far descending energy which, flowing from God, energizes the whole system of nature. He's making my case. He's talking about providence in the sense of bringing the doctors together, to bring the doctors to the patient and the procedures to the patient. But he fails to make the distinction about what is natural and what is supernatural. Now, I am almost out of time for this morning, but I want to make mention of something, and this is where, Lord willing, we're going to pick up next week in this study. So we've talked about the distinctions between the miraculous and providential, the definition of what is miraculous. Now, just I'm going to introduce this to you for your consideration and thought for the next week. And I'm going to throw you a list of scriptures just very quickly, and then I'm going to close and we're going to move forward into our worship assembly. I've got about 1 minute according to my watch. And that is, I'm going to talk about the Dodge. No, not the car manufacturer. I'm going to talk about the Dodge that modern-day miracle workers use because they cannot produce miracles. They can't work miracles. They say, here's what I've heard so many times. We don't do the miracles. God does. Well, there's a sense in which, yeah, that's true. But the sense in which they use it is false. Now, I'm going to give you some passages. And by the way, that idea that we don't perform miracles, God does, it just reveals a pathetic ignorance of what the Bible teaches. It's an ignorance of the Bible of almost immeasurable magnitude. I'm going to give you a list of passages. And Lord willing, we're going to come back next week and we're going to talk about these passages. But all of these passages have one deal. All of these passages deal with the miraculous, and they all have a singular thing in common. All right. So I'm going to give you these, and you can write these down. Do it in shorthand. All right. Matthew 10, verses 5 through 8. Mark 16, verses 17 through 20. Acts 3, verses 1 through 12. All the rest of these are Acts, so you can just start stringing these out after this. Acts 3, 1 to 12. Acts 4, 16. Acts 4, 29 and 30. Acts 5, 12 to 16. Acts 6, 8. And Acts 8, 5 to 8. And 8:13. And so those are the texts I want you to read. They all pertain to the miraculous, but they all have another singular commonality. And that's where we're going to begin as we discuss the dodge from those who preach miracles but fail to practice them. And so that's where we're going to close out for this session on miracles, number two. I'll make a note here. That'll be April the 19th. All right. Now, we want to get ready to enter into our worship assembly and get some things in order. I don't have any new results or any new news for our folks with regard to any sickness, but I do have some good news. And this a lot of this will be in the bulletin that I'll mail you. This is for our folks. The bulletin that I'll mail tomorrow, and that is that Rose McCarley, who is one of our members that is in the Hamilton Nursing Home, has tested negative for the coronavirus, and we are certainly thankful for that. I have not heard any word on Pat's test. I know that all of the residents were tested, I believe it was last Friday, and that there are a number of tests that have been returned. I don't know anything about Pat. Those of you from Burleson that know my girl Rhonda, not the one I'm married to, my girl Rhonda in the nursing home, her test came back negative as well. She called me yesterday, and I'm so thankful to receive that news about her. But there are more than a half a dozen or so residents that we know of who have tested positive. Some of them are we have a brother in Christ who has tested positive. We have a sister in Christ who's tested positive. A number of other residents have also tested positive. A number of the staff has tested positive. So we want to continue to remember all those in our prayers. And if you have any news that you want to give me today, you can text it or email it to me or send it to me via Messenger, and I'll do my best to update the bulletin before I mail it first thing tomorrow. So that's all the announcements that I have with regard to our sick folk. And again, if there's anything that needs to be added, I'd be happy to receive it by text, or you can call me later on today, or send me an email, or send me a messenger note. So we want to begin this morning, and we're going to read the first 30 verses of John 19. John 19, we're going to read the first 30 verses. And after that, we'll have our prayer. And then we will have some words pertaining to the Lord's Supper before the observance of the supper. And then at the conclusion after that, we'll have our morning sermon. John 19, beginning in verse number 1. So then Pilate took Jesus and scourged him, and the soldiers twisted a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe. Then they said, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they struck him with their hands. Pilate then went out again and said to them, "Behold, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no fault in him." Then Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate said to them, "Behold the man!" Therefore, when the chief priests and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "You take him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to our law, he ought to die because he made himself the Son of God." Therefore, when Pilate heard that saying, he was the more afraid and went again into the praetorium and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Are you not speaking to me? Do you not know that I have the power to crucify you and power to release you?" Jesus answered, "You could have no power at all against me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who delivered me to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, saying, "If you let this man go, you are not Caesar's friend. Whoever makes himself a king speaks against Caesar." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus out and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, but in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the preparation day of the Passover, and about the sixth hour. And he said to the Jews, "Behold your king." But they cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." Then he delivered him to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and led him away. And he, bearing his cross, went out to a place called the Place of the Skull, which is in Hebrew, Golgotha, where they crucified him, and two others with him, one on either side, and Jesus in the center. Now Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Then many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Therefore the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'He said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments in each and made four parts to each soldier apart, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. They said therefore among themselves, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it might be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots.'" Therefore the soldiers did these things. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother, and the disciple whom he loved standing by, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, "I thirst." Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Let's pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we're thankful again for this day. Father, we're thankful for the opportunity we have to worship Thee on the first day of the week, to worship Thee, the only living and true God, the giver of all life, of every good and perfect gift, the sustainer of life, and Father, the one who will one day send His Son back to this earth to receive that kingdom and deliver it up to Thee, Father, to destroy the world and bring judgment to all mankind. Father, we pray that we'll live our lives in view of this truth, but not only in view of it, but in hope of it, that we might be found in Christ without spot and blameless when He returns. Father, we're mindful of the fact that we sin and fall short of Thy glory, and we pray for Thy forgiveness, and we pray for Thy strength to encourage to live above sin and to live above the temptations that draw us into sin and spiritual death. We pray for, again, our nation, and the things that are ongoing with the virus. We pray for our leaders at the highest levels. We pray for our respective governors. We pray for those that rule more locally, and we ask that you would give them clarity of mind. Father, give them a sense of reasonableness. Father, give them the vision that they need to move forward, that we might as a nation be recovered from this virus, that people can go back to work, go back to doing the things that they love and need to do. Father, we're mindful of the threat of bad weather today and tonight. Father, we realize that many of our friends and loved ones and many that we do not know lie in harm's way. And Father, we pray that whatever damage these storms might bring might be minimal. We pray that whatever loss of property might be minimal. And Father, we pray for no loss of health and no loss of life. And we pray that you will help us to act judiciously, cautiously, Father, to act intelligently and with discernment as we face these storms that are coming through our area this afternoon and tonight. And again, Father, we just ask that you would spare all involved. Father, we pray that you'll be with us through our exercise of worship this morning, and that what we say and do will be pleasing in thy sight, that we'll be edified by our time here together, that you'll be honored, that you'll be lifted up, that you'll be glorified, you'll be exalted, not only in our words, but in our hearts and in our actions, this day and all days moving forward, in Jesus' name, amen. I want to think just for a few moments before the Lord's Supper about the matter of the resurrection. Now, many people are focused today on the resurrection because this is what is commonly referred to as Easter Sunday. Now, there is no such thing in our New Testament about Easter Sunday. There is no record of the early church recognizing Easter Sunday. The word Easter does not even appear in our Bibles, although it does appear in the King James Bible in Acts chapter 12. I think it's about verse 4 or 5, and that in and of itself is a horrendous rendering because the word there is Passover. The word there that is rendered Easter is rendered Passover 100 other times in our New Testament. And the idea of Easter Sunday is a human innovation. However, it is rooted in some degree of validity. Not in the idea of Easter, but in the idea that this Sunday would be the Sunday of the resurrection of Christ. Because Easter, as it is observed in the United States and in the realm of Christendom, is tied to the Passover. And the Passover is a lunar holiday. And so therefore, we can know when Easter is going to be only because we only know when Passover is going to be. And we know that because of the orderliness of the universe and based on the Jewish calendar and the various moons, the new moons, etc. And so there is some validity to the observance of or the idea that this was in some way the day that Jesus was raised from the dead. However, because Easter doesn't fall on the same day every calendar year, then we really have no idea. So only in the general sense in that this is the first Sunday, the first Lord's Day after the Passover, only in that sense can it be said that this is in any way the day that Jesus was raised from the dead. The most important thing to remember is that Sunday is the day that Jesus was raised from the dead. And that the early church met every Lord's Day, every first day of the week, not to remember the resurrection of Christ, but to remember his death. But I want us to think a little bit about the resurrection just for a few moments and what it means to us in a biblical way. And I got about five or six things here I want us to think about. One of these is, what does the resurrection mean? In other words, the fact that Jesus is raised from the dead. What does that mean? It means that all of the Old Testament testimony about Jesus is true. John 5 and verse 39, it says, "You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they that do testify of me." And so Jesus said the Old Testament was giving testimony to him. And so with the resurrection of the dead, the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, all of the Old Testament scriptures that pertain to Jesus were proven to be true. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 4, it says that Jesus was declared to be the Son of God by the resurrection of the dead. Romans 1 and verse 4. It means the Old Testament testimony of Genesis 3 and verse 15, that one would be born of a woman and crush the head of Satan, was also true. And that came true in the death and the resurrection of Christ. And Galatians 4 and verse 4, when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, that he might redeem those that are under the law. It means that what God said to Abraham about the seed, his seed, blessing the whole world, was true. And in Galatians 3 and verse 16, speaking about Abraham and his seed, it says, "He saith not unto seeds as of many, but as of one." That's making the distinction between Isaac and Ishmael. "But as of one, and of thy seed, which is Christ." It says to us that what Moses said about Christ in Deuteronomy 18 and 19, about the prophet that would be raised up, that those prophecies about Christ are also true. And Peter quoted that in Acts 3 in verses 19 through 26. And then finally, it teaches us that what David had written in the Psalms, in Psalm 16, beginning in verse 8 through verse 11, that God will not allow his Holy One be left in Hades, neither to see corruption. And Peter quoted that verse in talking about the resurrection of Jesus from the dead on the first Pentecost after the death of Christ in Acts chapter 2. So it means that all the Old Testament testimony about Jesus is true. It means that the testimony that Jesus gave about himself is true. Now, there were other means or other testimonies that were given, but because Jesus is risen from the dead, everything that he said about himself is also true. And I found that to be a very compelling argument. I was watching a number of weeks ago, I was watching William Lane Craig being interviewed on Ben Shapiro's Sunday podcast. He has an extended, he has like a 1 hour Sunday podcast, and it's just him one-on-one with an individual. And obviously, Ben being an Orthodox Jew and William Lane Craig being a professed Christian and apologist made this point to Shapiro, because the idea that anybody could be raised from the dead didn't really matter to Shapiro, because he believes in the Old Testament testimonies of how people were raised from the dead. And he says, so what is so special about the fact that Jesus of Nazareth is raised from the dead? And Craig, man, he just, like a laser, he focused on it. He says, because Jesus predicted his resurrection from the dead. He predicted his death. He predicted his resurrection from the dead. And everything that he said about his death and about his resurrection came true. Therefore, all of the other testimony that Jesus made about himself, therefore, must also be presumed to be true. And at that point, Shapiro left that thing. Man, he ran away from that subject like a scalded dog. But Craig cut to the heart of the matter. When Jesus was raised from the dead, everything he said about himself was true. But then in John chapter 5, there are a number of witnesses that we can read about, that Jesus talked about in John 5, beginning of verse 31. He says, "If I bear witness of myself, my witness is not true." In other words, if I'm the only one that testifies about my own self, then that testimony, that's not good enough. In other words, a man's not allowed to be his only witness. But then in verse 32, he begins a discussion of at least five witnesses, in addition to himself, five witnesses that testified that Jesus was indeed who he said he was. He says, "There is another who bears witness of me, and I know that the witness which he witnesses of me is true. You have sent to John, and he has borne witness to the truth." He, verse 35, "was a burning and shining lamp, and you were willing for a time to rejoice in his light. So Jesus said, in addition to my own testimony, John testified of me. He is a witness to me. But then in verse 36, he says, but I have a greater witness than John's. For the works which the Father has given me to finish, the very works that I do bear witness of me that the Father has sent me. So Jesus says, John the Baptist is a witness. He says, and the very miracles that you have witnessed me perform are also testimony that I am who I say I am. And then he says in verse 37, and the Father himself who has sent me has testified of me. So John the Baptizer is witness. The miracles that Jesus performed was witness. The Father himself is witness. Verse 39, a verse I noted just a moment ago, the Scriptures are witness. You search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they that do testify of me. But then down to verse 45, our fifth and final witness, do not think that I shall accuse you to the Father. There is one who accuses you, Moses, in whom you trust. For if you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words? So Jesus said, in addition to his own testimony, there is the testimony of John. There is the testimony of the miraculous. There is the testimony of the Father. There is the testimony of the Old Testament. And there is the testimony of Moses himself. So all the things that Jesus said about himself and all the things that others said about him bear out to be true. Number three, the resurrection means that the testimony of the apostles is true. Paul said, if Jesus is not risen, we are all liars. But of course, Paul knew that he was not a liar, for he himself had seen Jesus after his resurrection and after his ascension on the road to Damascus. And so the testimony of the apostles was true. The testimony from the day of Pentecost about Jesus being raised from the dead was true. If Jesus was not risen from the dead, the body could have been produced. The Jews could have went to the tomb. They knew where Jesus had been buried, but what had they done? They had paid the soldiers to say that the disciples stole the body. And we'll talk a little bit about that, Lord willing, in our sermon in just a few moments. But the testimony of the apostles was true. The testimony of other witnesses was true. 1 Corinthians 15, after Paul talks about what constitutes the gospel in verses 1 through 4, in verses 5 through 8, he says Jesus was seen, he was seen, he was seen, he was seen. And in one instance, he said he was seen by more than 500 brethren at once. Some of them are dead, but most of them are still living, and you can ask them. So the testimony of the apostles, the testimony of the early witnesses, also true. But what else does it mean in a more practical sense? Well, it means that I can have the forgiveness of my sins. Because if Jesus is not risen from the dead, we are still in our sins, and we are of all men most to be pitied. Actually, we're without hope. If Jesus is not raised from the dead, we are without all hope. And then, number five, it means, the resurrection of Christ means that I can be raised to live with Jesus in eternity. In 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 14, God both raised up the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. In 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18, a great passage that teaches that those that are dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet with the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And so those are five great truths that are affirmed by the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Now, in just a moment, we're going to not celebrate, but we're going to commemorate the Lord's death. We do this today not because it is Easter, but because this is the day that the early church met and remembered the death of the Lord through the observance of the Lord's Supper. This was done every first day of the week. This is the testimony of the Scriptures, Acts 20 and verse 7. This is the testimony of all religious history from the earliest days of the church. We don't observe the Lord's Supper today because it's Easter. We observe the Lord's Supper today because it's Sunday. It's the first day of the week, and it is the Lord's Day. As I posted just a few moments ago, our observance of the Lord's Supper is not about an empty cave, but it's about an occupied cross. And that's why we observe the Lord's Supper, to remember the death of Christ. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 26. I hope that you have your communion supplies ready. This time we're going to offer thanks for the unleavened bread, which represents the body of Christ. So let's bow together and give thanks for the bread. Father in heaven, we're thankful for the great sacrifice that was made for us, the offering of your Son and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we take this bread in remembrance of his body and in thankfulness for it being given on our behalf. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's give thanks for fruit of the vine. Our Father, again, we come before you, giving you thanks for this fruit of the vine, given to us in representation of the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as it was shed on the cross to secure our redemption, and not ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. Father, we partake of this cup in remembrance of his blood, in Jesus' name, amen. As we move into our sermon portion this morning, I've got a sermon I've preached a number of times. In fact, I've preached it within the last few years here at Burleson, but I think it's one that certainly deserves our attention, not only today, but every day. The original title is, If I Could Tell You Something About Jesus, but I retitled it for this morning, 10 Things You Need to Know About Jesus. 10 things that you need to know about Jesus. And so, as Briscoe Darling would say, jump in and hold on, because we've got a lot of ground to cover and not a lot of time to cover it. 10 things you need to know about Jesus. Number one, you need to know that Jesus loves you. In John 15 and in verse number 12, he says, This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. And you are my friends. A greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. And you are my friends, if you do whatsoever I have commanded you. In John 13 and verse 34, he says, A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, you also ought to love one another. And by this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. In Galatians chapter 2 and verse number 20, Paul said, For I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Number one, the one thing you need to know about Jesus is, Jesus loves you. My favorite song is Jesus Loves Me. People kind of poo-poo and write off that song, brush it aside as being a child song. Just because we teach children that song early on in life doesn't make it a child song. What better message is there to teach a child or an adult? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me So Jesus loves you. Number two, the thing you need to know about Jesus is this: Jesus never sinned. The Bible does not use the word perfect to describe sinlessness. Whenever the Bible wants to convey to us the idea that Jesus never sinned, it just came right out and said it. Jesus never sinned. He did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 through 23. God made him to be sin for us who knew no sin. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 21. For we do not have a high priest who cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted, like as we are, yet without sin. Hebrews 4 and verse number 15. When the Bible wanted to say that Jesus was sinless, it just came right out and said, he never sinned. And when I think about the magnitude of that statement, it just absolutely boggles the mind that Jesus never did anything that he had to be sorrowful for, never did anything that he had to repent of, never said anything that was inconsistent with the will of God. And the most astonishing one to me, he never thought any thought that was inconsistent with the will of his Father. Jesus never sinned. That's why he's called the Lamb of God. He's without spot and without blemish, 1 Peter chapter 1. He's the Lamb of God, John 1 and verse 29, who takes away the sins of the world. He had to be a spotless lamb in order to serve as the sacrifice for our sin. Hebrews writer says in Hebrews 9, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, and that'll purge our conscience through his blood there in Hebrews 9:15, and then reading through verse 22, for without the shedding of blood there is no remission. Jesus never sinned. And then that idea from Hebrews 9:15 brings us to number three. You need to know that Jesus died for you. Now, the Bible teaches us that Jesus died for the whole world. He gave himself for our sins, but not for our sins only, but for the sins of the whole world. 1 John 2, verses 1 and 2, which is in contradiction to Reformed or Calvinist theology. The Bible teaches Jesus died for all men, not just some convoluted idea of the elect. Jesus gave himself a ransom for all. 1 Timothy 2 and verse 6. God wants all men to be saved. 1 Timothy 2 and verse 4. God is not willing that any should perish. 2 Peter 3 and verse 9. Jesus died for you. Whether you're a Christian, whether you're an infidel, an unbeliever, a skeptic, Jesus died for you. He died for the whole world, but in the verse that we noted just a moment ago, Paul particularized that death and particularized it to himself. He said, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I but Christ lives in me, and the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul made the sacrifice of Christ a personal one when he made that statement there in Galatians 2 and verse number 20. The illustration I always use in this particular context is that when my son was about 4 or 5 years old, he had a little, I hope he still has it somewhere, we may have it at the house, I think it's called the Believer's Bible. It's a little book of Bible illustrations and the Bible stories, and Jeffrey loved his little Bible, and we read out of it every night. But my dad's mother, my grandmother on my dad's side, bought Jeffrey a bookmark for that Bible. And it had John 3:16 on it. Except where it says, for God so loved the world, his bookmark said, for God so loved Jeffrey that he gave his only begotten son. And every person that has ever lived, is living now, or will ever live, can write their name in that same spot, on that same bookmark that Jeffrey had. For God so loved, put your name right there.
that he gave his only begotten son. And the magnitude of that thought, to think that if I was the only person, or if you were the only person who was ever going to respond in obedience to the good news of Jesus, you were the only one who was ever going to take advantage of the precious shed blood of Jesus Christ, you need to understand this one thing. If you were going to be the only one out of the multiplied billions, Jesus still would have gone to the cross for you. He still would have gone to the cross for you. Jesus loves you. Jesus never sinned. And Jesus died for you. But it was already noted, number four, and we won't spend a whole lot of time here, that Jesus is risen from the dead. The fourth thing you need to know, that Jesus died, but he's not dead now. Jesus is alive. He is risen. In Matthew 28, and Mark 16, and Luke 24, there are a number of testimonies to the fact that Jesus was raised from the dead. Not only was he raised from the dead, but he was raised from the dead on the third day, just like he said in John chapter 2. He said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. And it says, and afterward his disciples understood he was talking about the temple of his body. And so he was talking about his resurrection from the dead. And Jesus is risen from the dead. And there are a number of theories and crackpot ideas that have been offered up to defend the idea that Jesus is not risen from the dead. For example, some people say, well, the disciples stole the body of Jesus. That's what they paid the soldiers to say. And yet, why would the disciples suffer the loss of all things? Why would they allow their families? Look, the apostles were not like modern day televangelists. They didn't get rich off peddling some version of the gospel. They lost everything. You know, they didn't fly around in private jets. They didn't have $10,000 suits and multi-million dollar homes. They lost everything for their testimony of Jesus. They had to see their own friends and loved ones tortured and killed. And again, according to secular history, although we do have note with regard to James, that he was beheaded by Herod in Acts chapter 12, according to religious history, all of the apostles suffered violent deaths except for John. Now, why would somebody steal a body and then lose everything, including their earthly possessions and their own lives, in defense of a lie? That's just the most foolish thing anybody might ever offer up. The Jews didn't have the body. Because if the Jews had the body, they would have produced it on the day of Pentecost, and Christianity would have never got off the ground. And then there are some religious folks who think, well, Jesus just passed out. It's called the swoon theory, that Jesus just became unconscious. He didn't really die. They thought he was dead. They put him in the tomb, and then he revived. You know, laid there for 3 days after being scourged and crucified, spear thrust in his side, laid in a tomb, dark, damp, cold, no water, no food, no medical attention. And then he just woke up and snuck out past the guards. I mean, as we say in Alabama, that doesn't even make good nonsense. I've heard somebody say, well, Mary went to the wrong tomb. The disciples went to the wrong tomb. You know, of all the foolish ideas, look, there's only one plausible explanation for the empty tomb. And that explanation is this: Jesus is risen from the dead. And that's the end of the story. But then number five, here's something you need to know about Jesus. When you meet Jesus, you got to make a decision. In Matthew chapter 4, Jesus went out and began to call his disciples, call the apostles specifically. And what did he say? Follow me, Mark 1:17, follow me, and I will cause you or make you to become fishers of men. James and John, Peter and Andrew, they were all called from their workplace. There was a decision that had to be made. What were we? Are we going to do? Are we going to continue fishing? Are we going to continue our secular work? Or are we going to follow Jesus? They made that decision. In Matthew chapter 9, the tax collector sitting at the receipt of custom, Jesus said, follow me. What did he do? He left everything sitting right there at that table. rose up and followed Jesus. And then you have the rich young ruler who refused to follow Jesus because he had more faith in his money than he did in Jesus and his heavenly Father. And then you have Pilate. Pilate had to make a decision about Jesus. And here's really the sad part about Pilate's decision. Pilate made his decision, and it went against everything he knew to be true. He knew the Jews delivered Jesus because of envy, Mark 15 and verse 10. He found no fault in him, John chapter 19. He washed his hands and said, I'm innocent of the blood of this just man. In Matthew 27, 19, his own wife said, don't have anything to do with this just man. I've suffered many things in a dream because of him this day. Every bit of available evidence screamed to Pilate, Jesus is innocent. You need to turn him loose. But he just didn't have the backbone to do what he knew was right. He made a decision, and the sad thing is he made a decision that flew in the face of all the facts. But then number six, I tell you this, I cannot accept Jesus and reject his doctrine. You need to know that. You cannot say Jesus yes, church no, Jesus yes, doctrine no. There is no separating Jesus from his doctrine. In John chapter 12 and verse 48, Jesus said, he who rejects me and does not receive my words has one who judges him. The words that I have spoken, the same will judge him in the last day. And not only that, not only must we hear the words of Jesus, we must hear those who speak the words of Jesus. Luke 10 and verse number 16. So I cannot accept Jesus and refuse to obey what he said. Again, if you love me, keep my commandments. He who has my commandments and keeps them is he who loves me. John 14 verses 21 to 23. This is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. 1 John 5 beginning in verse 1. I cannot accept Jesus and reject his doctrine. Number seven, here's what you need to know. You cannot accept Jesus and reject his church. He is the head of the body, the church. Colossians 1 and verse 18. God gave him head over all things to the church, to be head over all things to the church, which is his body. Ephesians 1, 22 and 23. The body of Christ is the means by which all men, Jew and Gentile, are reconciled unto God. Colossians chapter 1. It's not Jesus yes, church no. Jesus yes, church no is a decapitated, is a disembodied head. That's what I almost said, a decapitated body, but that's not it. It's a disembodied head. It's taking the body and separating it from the head. But you got to have the head and the body, because when we obey the gospel, we're baptized into Christ, into his body. Galatians 3:27, 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 13. I cannot accept Jesus and reject his church. Think about what the Bible says about Saul of Tarsus. In Acts 8 and verse 3, it says that Saul made havoc of the church. But in chapter 9, Jesus said, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? See how the Bible says in verse chapter 8 of Acts that Paul persecuted the church. And in chapter 9, Jesus said, you're persecuting me. I cannot accept Jesus and reject his church. Number eight, here's what you need to know about Jesus. He is coming back. Jesus is coming back. Everything that we know about Jesus, everything that we can know about Jesus, tells us that what he says about his return must also be true. Everything he said about himself was true. All the witnesses of John 5 were true. Therefore, if Jesus predicted his death, he predicted his resurrection, he talked about his ascension, and if he said, I'm coming back, folks, you can take it to the bank, he's coming back. He says, I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you there you may be also. John 14, 1-6. Jesus is coming back. He, without doubt, he is coming back. Now, Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 3 that in the last days would come some scoffers and said, where's the promise of his coming For since the fathers passed away, all things continue as they have since the creation. In other words, they willingly forgot the flood. That the whole world changed in the flood. That things were no longer the same as they were before the flood. But think about this. Jesus had only been gone about 30 years. He'd only been gone about 30 years, and they're already scoffing that a man who performed miracles and is resurrected from the dead, they're scoffing that he's not coming back. Here we are, we're nearly 2,000 years down the road from that, and he's still not come back. But I'll guarantee you one thing, you better be ready. You better be ready. He's coming back. If everything else he said is true, then the fact that he said he's coming back is also true. Then number 9, this is what you need to know about Jesus. If you reject Jesus, you reject your only hope to be saved. There is no other way to get to God. I don't care what Oprah says or anybody else. There's no other way to get to God except through Jesus Christ. All the Jews have to, all modern day Jews have to reject Judaism and embrace Christianity. All Muslims have to reject Muhammad and embrace Jesus. All Buddhists have to reject Buddha and embrace Jesus. And you can just substitute whatever religious error there is out there, and it all boils down to this. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father but by me. That's what Jesus said in John 14 and verse number 6. He is the only way to God. He's the only door. John chapter 10. We only have access to the Father through His blood. Friend, if you reject Jesus, you reject the only hope you have of being saved. And then lastly, I'll tell you this. This is one more thing. And this goes all the way back to the first one. Jesus wants you to be saved. He said, I did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. Luke 9 and verse 56. I'm come to seek and to save that which is lost. Luke 19 and verse 10. Jesus loves you. Jesus lived for you. Jesus died for you. Jesus was raised for you. Jesus is coming back because he wants you to be saved. He's coming back, but you have to prepare yourself. It's oftentimes been said, heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. And the only way to be prepared is to obey the words of Jesus. And in conclusion, we'll summarize with just these simple statements from the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said we must hear His words and understand them, Matthew 15 and verse number 10. Jesus said we have to believe in Him, John 3 and verse 16. If we don't believe that He is, we'll die in our sins, John 8 and verse 24. And by the way, these are all red letters. Not that the red are more important than the black, but I'm telling you what Jesus said. That except you believe that I am, you'll die in your sins. Jesus said we must repent of our sins or perish, Luke 13:3 and Luke 13:5. Jesus said we must be willing to confess our faith in Him before men, Matthew 10 and verse number 32. Jesus said we must be baptized. We must confess Him before men, Matthew 10:32, and be baptized in order to be saved, Mark 16. And verses 15 and 16. That baptism is based upon our hearing and belief in the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved. Mark 16, 15 and 16. And then Jesus said this, we must endure unto the end in order to be saved. Matthew 10. Verse 22, that's in spite of the hatred that we'll receive, verses 21 and the first part of 22, and that we must be faithful even to the point of death, and He'll give us a crown of life, Revelation 2 and verse number 10. 10 things you need to know about Jesus. I hope that you're prepared for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, but if you're not, and we can help you in any way, I want you to contact me. You can send me a message in this thread through Messenger, email, call me, find me some way. And I'll be happy to study the Bible with you so that you can know with absolute certainty that you are prepared for the coming and the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's bow together and then we'll close out. Our Father in heaven, we're again thankful for this day, the opportunity we have to worship. We're thankful for the privileges of and the access to thy word. Father, we're thankful for its teaching. We're thankful for its correction. We're thankful for the hope that it gives us. And Father, we pray that we'll live and conduct ourselves in a way that exhibits that hope to the rest of the world, that we'll sanctify the Lord in our heart and be ready to give an answer to all who ask the reason of the hope that lies within us. Father, again, we pray for safety and security during this time of bad weather. We pray for those who are affected by it now and those who will be affected in the coming hours. Father, keep us safe in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you again so much for watching today. We appreciate you being with us. And if the Lord wills, we'll be back again tonight at 5:30. If the weather is bad, I will broadcast from the house. And Philip will monitor the number, the Google Voice number, and correspond with Rhonda. But Lord willing, if the power's on, we'll be here at 5:30, either here or at the house, and we hope that you'll join us at that time. Have a great Lord's Day, y'all.